State your name.
Good morning. My name is Tracy Hewitt, and I know I had the opportunity to introduce myself to you. I think it's been about a month ago. I am running for district court judge, and I've been a public defender and am currently a public defender. I've been doing that work for 11 and a half years. I've done numerous jury trials and bench trials, lots and lots and lots of motions, and I've been able to work with people one-on-one and really see, obviously, by definition, as a public defender, my clients live in poverty. So I've been able to see face-to-face every day, many, many, many times, the challenges that are faced by folks who live in a poverty situation. I love my work. I really want to get on the bench, and I really have two goals, and I think they can both be achieved. Keep the community safe and protect constitutional rights. Those are my two goals, and I appreciate your consideration and your vote. Thank you.
Step up, step up, step up. Run this circuit.
Are there any other candidates that would like to take the opportunity to speak? Please come forward.
Yes, yes, I'm Ben Tallheimer, and I'm a district court candidate, and unlike the rest of the district court candidates you're going to hear from today, I don't have a primary. I'm good to go until November. Let me explain a little. District court's a little confusing to some of you. It's a nonpartisan race. There's more than two challengers, there is a primary. Other people here do have challenges, and so they're having a primary. I'm a regular visitor here. I was a judge for 5 years in family court, hoping to return back to family court. That's my passion and my love. And I'll be talking to you later on as we get closer to November.
Good morning.
Morning.
My brothers and sisters, it's been so long. It's been a really tough road getting back to good health. But I'm back. Yeah. Praise God. Yeah. Praise God. Praise God. I wanted to take this moment to thank each and every one of you for all the support that you gave me in 2008 and 2012. You know, I'm Charlotte Brown, only Brown Williams for elections. I dropped the Williams back in 2009. Christy signed my divorce papers. But my seat is an open seat. You heard from me, and there are four candidates, and I want to introduce a couple of candidates, and I want to introduce one of my good colleagues, Christy Mann, this morning. You'll hear from her. But I want you to know that serving on the district court bench is the people's court, and you know that. It's a community. It's not about the Lord. Yes, we follow the Lord. You can read. We don't went to law school. We passed the bar. We follow the Lord, but it's about people. It's about understanding you. It's about understanding your problems, your situations, community. And you know, that's what I've represented all the time since I've been on the bench. And I can say that the people who are running today represent the same thing. But I want to introduce Paulina Habelka. Paulina was my co-campaign manager in 2012 when I was really ill. She held up my arms for me. She's running for my seat. Faith Finland, a wonderful, wonderful attorney, does most of the judge's week, but was fighting us about it. She's a great lawyer. And then I'll turn it over to Christy. Can you all say with me, thank God, Charlotte as well?
Thank God,
Charlotte as well.
Well, that's a little hard act to follow. Again, my name is Judge Christy Mann. I've been a judge since 2005. I've been an attorney for 30 years, specializing in family court. I was counting some numbers, about 40,000 matters I've heard over my 10 years, and that is a huge volume. The population of Mecklenburg County is 1 million people, so not only does justice have to be fair, the judge has to be knowledgeable, but you have to be able to get to work, get there early, work through lunch, because the children of Mecklenburg County and their families depend. had a case recently with the child who was just over a year old and he weighed 11 pounds. He was near death. And I came, there was an emergency, I came in early, made sure that child was placed with a grandparent who was able to then get the child medical care that he needed. They brought him back to see me 3 months later. He gained 8 pounds. He could sit up for the first time. And so those kinds of cases, that's an example of the thousands of cases that I hear. I have two opponents, so I'll have a primary. I would certainly appreciate your support. I think that I can do the job and have done the job that helped not only the citizens, but in my humble opinion, the children, the next generation of Mecklenburg County. Thank you. With Christy Mann. I'm the best man for the job.
Good morning. I'm Faith Bickley, and I'm honored to have been introduced by Judge Charlotte Brown. I'm also honored to know that when I become your next district court judge, I'll be replacing such a wonderful judge. I've had the honor and privilege actually to appear before Judge Brown as well as Judge Christy Mann. And I've been practicing in Mecklenburg County been practicing law for 9.5 years. I work at Legal Aid in North Carolina. And for those of you who don't know, we represent people with low income or people with equal access to the judicial system. I would love to do the same thing on the bench, making sure and ensuring that everyone has equal access to the system. And right now I'm the supervising attorney for the domestic violence unit, and I represent victims of domestic violence and obtain domestic violence protective orders, sometimes do limited custody proceedings for them, child support proceedings for them. Also represent tenants in landlord tenant matters before district court judges, small claim court to in front of magistrates, but in front of district court judges, ensuring that they have safe and equal access to housing. Represent consumers in that if they are debtors and making sure that their property is not improperly seized by creditors. Essentially, anything that civilly affects traditionally poor people in our community is what we do at Legal Aid. It's what I've done. It's why I went to law school, and I love to make sure that this judicial system is meeting out the right, proper, and access to the judicial system. Thank you.
We'll have one last, and then we're going to go ahead and get started because our speaker is here.
I will make it quick.
Thank you.
Good morning. My name is Paulina Havelka. I started out in the clerk's office, actually in district court in 1997. And when I sat there for the first time, I thought when the judge spoke, I was hearing the language French, because I didn't understand what was going on. Within a month's time, I was on my own in a courtroom with the judge, and I was inspired to actually go to law school because I felt that everybody deserved justice, deserved fairness, and deserved to be treated like a human being when they're in front of a judge. In 2005, I started my own practice. I have practiced in juvenile court, which is exclusive jurisdiction of district court. I have practiced in criminal court. I have practiced in family court. I've also handled some civil matters. The one thing I can say is that I'm diverse. I can find myself and be comfortable in every courtroom and aspect of district court. And I am comfortable and confident that I will make a great judge. I appreciate your vote. I appreciate your consideration. And I just want you to know that every day I work, I'm passionate about what I do, and I believe in justice for all. Thank you very much for having me.
Thank you to all the candidates. Let me just give them a quick round of applause for coming in impromptu. And I will say there is one candidate that was not here today. She is normally here. She is also running for Judge Brown's seat. Her name is Aretha Blake. She's currently the president of the Mecklenburg Bar Association. She normally does come. I know she had some things this morning, but she is a regular face in here, so I thought it would be fair. Introduce her as a potential candidate as well. We're going to go ahead and get started with our regular program. So are there any first-time attendees here? Okay, you can introduce yourself to us. So welcome again. Thank you for coming. Anybody anybody else, is this your first time coming? Okay, so we all know kind of how this will go this morning. We have our speaker, Mr. Graham, if you will come forward. Patrick Graham is here with us. He is president of the Charlotte Urban League, and we're going to give him some time to speak, and then we'll take questions. Please make sure you just raise your hand. I'll mark them all down. We'll take them in the order in which we receive. You go ahead and have a seat. And we're just going to have a quick prayer. Dr. Maloney, can you just give us a very brief prayer, and then we'll get started.
Talking to the Lord, you don't want to be too brief. I saw the voice of God and climbed up on the steeple. The God declared, come down again. I dwell among the people. Please repeat after me. Lord, help us to be strong in mind.
Lord, help us to be strong in mind.
Lord, help us to be pure in heart.
Lord, help us to be pure in heart.
Lord, help us to be vigilant. Helpfulness. Lord, help us to be better workers in your divine kingdom.
Lord, help us to be better workers in your divine kingdom.
As we co-create with you,
as we co-create with you,
building the kingdom of heaven.
Building the kingdom of heaven.
On earth. As it is in heaven.
As it is in heaven.
The church, the synagogue, the mosque, all other religious institutions. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Dr. You all can come on in, grab a seat. We're just getting started. So I will go ahead and turn it over to Ms. Graham. Time to introduce yourself and tell us this morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
My name is Patrick Graham. I'm President CEO of the Urban League of Central Carolinas. And it's a pleasure to be here with you this morning, not just to talk about the Urban League, but really to talk about how we connect systems in this community to create economic and social mobility for all. So I want to start out by first giving a brief history of the Urban League itself. Of the Urban League itself, as well as the Urban League of Central Carolina and its local community, and why I feel so important. Many people don't know this, but I actually not only been in the social sector for over 20 years, but I've also been a professor of Africana studies as well as civil rights for the past 20 years. My doctorate in American history with a focus in civil rights and community development. And I write on migration as well as civil rights. And so the Urban League itself obviously really marries those two concepts because it was founded in 1910 in New York as a result of the Great Migration. But as you had urban centers develop in the South, that movement moved to the South. So if you look at the Southeast, we have more national Urban League affiliates in the Southeast than you have in any region in the country. So most people don't realize that. And the reason that is that if you look at any economic mobility study, if you look at any of the past works over the last 20 plus years, come to realize that poverty has become highly concentrated now in the Southeast. So it's no surprise that when you saw the economic mobility study with Harvard and Chetty, cities like Atlanta, Charlotte, Memphis, and others showed up in the bottom, as well as Greensboro and Fayetteville. And that's because we have a high concentration of poverty in the Southeast. And so the Urban League, when it started in 1910, which is the oldest African-American direct service organization in the world, started to deal with people who were migrating and wanted to help them with housing as well as jobs. If you look at today's landscape, some of the main issues that plague communities is this notion of ownership, housing, jobs, entrepreneurship, as well as some of the social justice issues that take control right now of our headlines every day. This Urban League, though, started in 1978. A group of community leaders got together and said, we have to do something about disparities in employment along racial and ethnic lines in this city. And so when this group got together to form it, they commissioned a study with UNC Charlotte and Johnson C. Smith. And in that joint study, they recommended that we start an Urban League affiliate in this city. And that's how it got started. But today, obviously, we're not just doing basic workforce and education programs, but we're doing more than that. We're actually trying to connect low to moderate income people to our economy. And I'm going to talk about how we do that in a moment. So our mission is very clear: to empower the community to attain financial stability and social justice in a global economy through education, training, and placement. So the main focus is, how do we take communities that have traditionally been pushed out of our economic and educational systems and find ways for them to entrance into them? About 4 years ago, we launched an initiative and book called The State of Ethnic Charlotte. So many of you have heard a lot about economic mobility in this community, and we've used the Chetty study as well as others. But here is a reality. In 2011, we launched The State of Ethnic Charlotte, which was a book that predicted, if you read it, that we would be one of the lowest ranking communities in economic mobility based on the data and trajectories we saw this community going in. So in many ways, we became prophets in our own town. That is, we couldn't necessarily get everyone to hear our voice that this was about to occur dramatically because of the economic downturn, as well as our large policies of segregation in this community. Now, people say, well, why do you use the term policy? Well, I use the term policy because policies are both formal and informal. And so one of the things that this community is facing, as it does with other Southeast cities, is our economic and social isolation of communities is creating lower economic mobility. And the reason I say that is it doesn't just prove itself in the data, but it proves itself in our history. If you look at communities over the past 50 years that have been struggling in terms of education and mobility, and I challenge you to look at this, those are going to be communities and states that have had the harshest segregation laws and informal segregation practices after. So think about places like Georgia, South Carolina, traditionally though they're trying to make some changes. Think about Mississippi. All of these that have struggled in terms of their economic development were those that shut out large portions of their population. So if Mississippi, for example, in certain parts, 50% African American, if you suppress that many people, then your economic growth cannot occur because you're losing too much intellectual capital. And that's why it's important that we understand that, because that's the context in which the Urban League operates. Our core values, I'm not going to go through all of them, but there's two that I really want to make sure people understand. That we do believe education, training, and placement services are a pathway to financial stability and dignity. But this is where we think that
we really make an impact in terms of leadership. That is, if you do not support marginalizing people in the community by referring to them as at risk, but believe deeply in their potential as human capital and refer to people we serve as at opportunities. And the reason we use the term at opportunity is because, unlike communities that we've seen historically, if we don't view folks as an opportunity for us, not an opportunity just to help, not an opportunity just to support, but an opportunity for them to be very much a part of who we are, then we as a community suffer. And so in 2012, I had my board literally sign a resolution that made part of our bylaws that you could never use the term at risk in our facility again. People had to be referred to as at opportunity. It gained so much, it really gained a lot of momentum because the National Urban League actually had us present that at the National Conference. And they were gonna try to actually bring that to a vote to have that be implemented across the nation with all Urban League affiliates, all 93 of them. What's also equally important is that other organizations, if you think about the Goodwills and others, have adopted sort of that same notion, the notion of opportunity. And we have been very much a part of leading that charge to ensure that we start to view people differently. So in our community, we want change. And everyone talks about change, and we come at it from different perspectives. But the one thing that I want to make sure that I leave you today is that we have to look at the actual players of change, and that is individuals, community, and then systems. You can't have change unless these three are somehow in alignment and are somehow connected. So this next busy graph here is something which I call the continuum of opportunity for social and economic mobility. At the very top, we have what we call our mobility ecosystem. So this is a cross-sector of many systems. This is our health system, it's our economic development systems, it's our social justice systems. All of those educational systems must have some dialogue, some connectivity between them. What often happens, though, is that there is no connectivity between them. So it's very hard for someone to understand why locking up 16 and 17-year-olds as adults in your social justice system also affects your economic system. Because you're actually taking talent, youthful talent, in a community that's aging out, and literally cutting off some of your intellectual capital for future growth. So those are the types of things that we have to begin to connect and understand that it's not just a moral issue, but it's also an economic and social issue. Then you have what are called sector systems or continuums. So these are systems that operate in networks. So you have things like your homeless services network. You have things like your digital inclusion network. You have things like your workforce sector networks. Those networks must begin to have cross-sector conversation. If they don't have cross-sector conversation and they're not on the same page in terms of moving people forward with common goals, then what occurs is that you have a lot of people doing a lot of activity, but not a lot of impact. Amen. And there's a difference between activity and impact, right? I can literally be in Raleigh tomorrow and launch the largest protest and still come away with nothing, right? So we have to be strategic and some of our conversation, both in protest as well as in policy. The other is networks and institutions or groups. So there are small groups of groups like this and other groups that meet where there's connectivity. There's neighborhoods and family. That's where you find most of the strongest connectivity. And so the challenge is, how do you take neighborhoods and families and individuals and have much more of a connection with our systems? That becomes important in terms of developing policies and strategies to deal with not just what ails us, but also with opportunities that we have for growth in this community. What often happens is we are focusing on problems that we need to solve, but I also think we need to focus on opportunities that we need to take. And if we view these communities that are low to moderate, which are highly underutilized, as those opportunities, we'll actually see that we'll make better headway here in Charlotte Falls. So there are some things that also prohibit us from moving forward. And so I call these things sort of the other things that prohibit us from having the courage to move forward, or even the belief that we can. So culture. Charlotte, for example, still has a culture of segregation. You can see it on any map. If you look at it from an economic standpoint, from a digital inclusion standpoint, I see Bruce here that I work with. If you look at it from an educational standpoint, or a racial standpoint, any map that you draw, and I've looked at many of them, you will see segregation as part of our culture. So that's one of the things that impedes our progress. How do we deal with that? Political and social will. What I often find is that we have not necessarily developed the political and social will to take the type of risk needed. Now, there's many elected officials in here, and I believe that many of you that I do know have the courage to move the correct policies forward. But there are times when some of your colleagues are too concerned with the next election cycle. When you have that type of concern, you can't have concern for the long play at hand, right? And so political and social will is one of the things that blocks our movement. Tolerance for change, the pain and endurance that it will require. So I talk often, for example, to folks on the task force, and the Economic Mobility Task Force, and had this conversation with them, and actually a couple of foundations and presentations around this notion of tolerance and endurance for pain. That means that in order for us to move forward, that it will come with some pain. If you want to desegregate schools, that's a painful experience. We've lived it before. The one way that I believe that we can do that, for example, and I'll just leave you with one, obviously, is not just mixed income housing, but mixed income housing with an emphasis on ownership. So I just wrote a chapter for Wake Forest in a book coming out on African-American families. And I start off with my first education policy as mixed income housing with an emphasis on ownership. So that means taking people into other communities and not just placing, say, 30% of our low income market in rental housing, but actually how do you create for them ownership. So if you're going to subsidize rent over long periods of time, then instead subsidize ownership over long periods of time. So I'll give you an example. If you look at a first ward today, 30% of that population in first ward were people who are low income and are renters, and you had 70% that were middle to upper income ownership. What I would say is cut that 30% in half, take half of that 30%, and actually take the same subsidies, with training in financial literacy, as well as assistance in job creation, and actually have those people home. That way the subsidy will offset some of the tax increase and allow them to take full advantage of the growing equity. Because over the last 50 years, a young man by the name of Ragnelli out of MIT just did a study that debunks most of our well-known economists. And what he found is that over the last 50 years of all capital investments, only one has showed positive growth. All the rest were either flat or negative. And that one was housing and land. Still, over the last 50 years, housing and land. So the notion of ownership is still very much important. I'll just go through the others. Intellectual inclusion is a problem that we must face. Perceived capacity. So we talk about this notion of, do we have enough capacity? Do we have enough dollars? What's interesting is we don't talk about us having meager resource until it's time to talk about sharing. We have a lot of resources. We find resources for a lot of things. But when it's time to talk about sharing in capital, we often then, as a default, go back to this notion of we don't have the capacity. So what would a continuum of opportunity for social and economic mobility look like from our standpoint? It starts at education, employment and workforce development, that we start early on, even in pre and post-secondary education. Economic development, development of entrepreneurs, supplier and small business diversity, financial literacy and services, health and human services for wraparound services, and then obviously advocacy, public and private policy. And I focus a lot on private and public because it won't just be government, but it also will require many of our private institutions, particularly in the for-profit sector, to implement things that develop more inclusion. And so a lot of times we are talking about this from a government level, but I actually meet with a lot of companies to talk about policies related to their internal work and how that influences mobility in our community. So I gave you this graph because I just want to show you something. If you look at this graph, one is from 2009, one from 2013. The red is 2009. This is data from the state of ethnic Charlotte, the first one in red. And as you can see back then, the median income for a white household was $69,446. For an African American household at the time, it was $40,648. Today, 2013, the latest data shows us that the median income for a white household is $70,000 plus, and the median income for an African American household is 37. And you see also for Hispanic and Latino, largest growth occurring in Asian households. So why do I show you that? One of the things that we have to do is that we are going to have to really hold ourselves to the fire in terms of measuring whether we are heading in the right direction or not. That was the whole purpose of the State of Ethnic Charlotte. It was to look at measurements and policies and then see if we're actually moving in the right direction. So the reality is that in this community, though we've talked about an economic recovery, we've actually gone backwards in terms of our equality indexes. And you see that, obviously, in that data. So I just want to give you that as an example. So here's some of the things I want to sort of speed through these so I can allow for some questions. So here are some of the things that the Urban League is doing to address mobility from our end. We have what we call a linking youth to technology and youth program platform. So we do technology development for math, reading, writing, and science for third to eighth graders. And so we do that by actually taking those in third grade through eighth grade and through an online application, we actually help them get at their core curriculum by using technology. And what's important about that is that at schools like Rivergate or Sterling Elementary, CMS has reported that those youth in our programs have had 40 to 60% gains in pass rates on their end of grade testing. So we know that it works. We also offer national certification for high school students in Cisco, broadband, fiber optics. And here's something that I wanted to let this community know that many are unaware of. The Urban League here is the largest provider of nationally certified fiber technicians in the state. Over 100 a year. Something that most people wouldn't know. Juvenile justice for middle school, so we actually do work with the juvenile justice system here as a grantee, but we also just recently brought in national dollars to also help youth who have been in the juvenile justice system with education, workforce development, and job placement. GED and high school partnerships that we have with CPCC, and through the initiative, the Urban League Bank with Carolina Premier, we have youth saving and bank accounts. So we use financial literacy as a tool, but we actually also use the bank as a way to give them real experience with a real product. For adults, we have a Work Smart Certified, which is a life skills curriculum shared with eight other workforce agencies. We were the first agency to call a meeting together to have what we call a universal life skills curriculum across the workforce sector for all people going through workforce programs. Job readiness, we have national certifications in premise cabling, fiber technician, Microsoft specialist, customer service, HVAC, and the reason that we chose some of these fields is because they had cross-pollinization across other disciplines and other types of workforce. So for example, in fiber, we place people with telecommunications companies, but also we place them with energy companies. So solar, others. If you were to go up 85, down 85, past Kings Mountain, you'll notice a large solar field there. Over half that labor was provided by us. Young people between the ages of 18 and 24. Young people working. As a matter of fact, one young man is actually working for a group called Strata Solar out of Raleigh, one of the largest solar providers here. He is one of their lead field supervisors, formerly incarcerated, but now an opportunity for Strata Solar. Entrepreneurship Academy, we have our partnership with City Startup Labs. We also have the Turner School for Contract Management, and we'll be launching with the Support Center as well as the Small Business Administration a new program called Safe Place Lending for Entrepreneurs. This program will focus on minority and women businesses that have been in existence for 2 years, and we will put them through an 8-week course to help them develop capacity and connect them to lenders. Financial Literacy and Services, Job Fair, and Placement Services. So here's the impacts of that. With youth, as reported by the schools, those in our programs experience 91% grade gains for all youth programs. I've already cited what you've seen in Rivergate. For those youth who are taking our national certifications, the same one adults take. So that means a person will come out with a fiber certification, a Cisco certification before they leave high school. 80% pass rate on all national exams. For adults, it's 95% pass rate for national exams. 73% job placement within 6 months. 84% retention rate for those placed. The income for these people is increased threefold. Average person coming to us is making less than $10,000 a year. And by the way, all of these are free to them. But here's the big thing. Over the last 5 years, our graduates have earned $94.27 million in salary. Last year, we broke a record in fiscal year 2015, and in that 1 year alone, our graduates earned $34.21 million in salaries. $6.5 million has been given in minority and women business loans, and the average salary for a person leaving our program is around $1,298. Right now, mobile living wage for a single individual in this community is put at 11. I think that's too small of a number. I don't think it's quite accurate. But as you can see, we're almost $2 ahead of that. And our investment ratio is something else we're proud of. For every dollar that went into our workforce programs, about $800,000, a little over $800,000, $41 plus went back out into the community. That means when you take $800,000 and you divide it into that 34 million, you come up with an investment ratio of 1 to 41. We believe that that's important because we have to measure whether we're actually making an impact or not. And so now we're talking about over 1,400 people last year placed. They're in the community, working, earning an income, and supporting their families. This you can't see, but it's an example of a what we call a community-wide continuum of opportunity. Taking education programs, like I said, mixed income housing with emphasis on ownership, reading on level by third grade, etc., and economics, demand-based workforce practices, asset development through inclusive housing, health, focus on birth rates, family structure, mental health issues. Under social justice, we want to reform the incarceration of minors in the adult systems. We have really focused a lot on that 16 to 17 year old population because we are only one of two states that does this in our country. The other is New York, and I believe they are about to change. Cultural, we want to make sure that there's a more STEAM focus, so science, technology, engineering, arts and math in schools, cross-cultural education for youth and adults, and greater access to public and cultural spaces. So with that, I thank you and ask if you have any questions.
Thank you very much. Just real quick before we go to our questions, I just want to acknowledge that Ms. Peterson is in the back of the room. Happy New Year!
Happy New Year!
Considering that the political will necessary requires some intestinal fortitude to move forward to correct those things where we've gone back.
That's a good question. Well, one is, I'll take the latter first. When we talk about political will, our community still is driven much more by corporate will than it is actually the public space. I mean, that's a reality. So it's not like some places I've known in the Northeast, for example, that have very strong political machines that drive things. We have much more of a corporate focus, which also helps in some development, particularly for upper class mobility, but doesn't necessarily leak down because of its conservative nature into lower class groups. And I'll say this, one of the ways that you can see that happening is over a few years ago, most of the jobs, for example, that came into the Charlotte area, while we talk about the big sort of announcements we've seen recently and the types of salaries that are there, well, 40 plus percent of those jobs, though, have been low wage jobs when they come into the area. So that tells you something right there. Two is, if you look at Charlotte as a map and where we have concentrated poverty, that has changed just like communities all across the country. For the first time about 10 years ago, we had more people in poverty in the suburbs than we had in urban centers. And that was due to in large part to a lot of the large gentrification projects that took place in these centers. Charlotte is one of those centers, and that has occurred here. So people have been pushed further out away from jobs. Think about when you first had the first line built on our train system, and you go up South Boulevard, why would you have not had any type of affordable housing development along that corridor? Why would that be in the plan? What would be the thought process by not having that, so people have more access to the jobs in which they work? Instead, if you looked at a map, you'll see that poverty has been pushed more out to what I call the second ring of our city, and eventually you will see that push out even further. So not only do you have individuals who are struggling to work, but they're struggling to get to work. So the political will is going to have to be much more in tune with policies and incentives to those who are building homes, those who are coming here as employees or employers, to actually hire and create housing opportunities that are closer together. I'll give you an example. I've really been urging some folks to seriously think about, when you're giving these contracts with government dollars, taxpayer dollars, that you might not be able to use racial preferences because of some of the laws that we have. But you can talk about, yeah, it's a difficult question to answer in a few minutes, but I'll hit this last point. But what you can do is actually have them hire a certain percentage from zip codes that are actually suffering in mobility. The mobility study we have is based off of zip codes. Because your zip code will determine your lot in life. If we want to change that, then we have to be very intentional about focusing energy on those zip codes. Not by just gentrifying them and moving people out, right? They then don't get to take advantage of the newfound prosperity, but how do you actually include them? That's one of the ways.
Thank you. Joel, your next question.
Hey, good morning. And Dr. Grant, it's always good to see you, and I enjoy your presentations and appreciate the work that the Urban League is doing, not only for Charlotte, but for the entire region. My question is one for you, as I listen to your presentation, and I did come a little bit late, but I can concede that there are some challenges within our political, corporate, and community systems to help our community as it relates to upward mobility. What I did not hear, and what I don't think that we hear enough of in our community, is what are we doing with the resources that we do have? I have a 10-year-old daughter, and I say this every time I speak publicly. My wife and I, we love her to life, and there's nothing we wouldn't do for her in this area. But one of the things that we cannot do for Trinity, we can't do Trinity's reading for her. Trinity has to do her reading. So help me balance the community, corporate, political responsibility with individual responsibility for our own upward mobility.
Good question. So, Joel, you probably didn't miss the slide when I talked about systems from the ecosystem all the way down to individuals and how there has to be connectivity between them. And so you're right that there is going to be obviously individual responsibility in them. What we have done, though, almost too much, is that we've placed a lot of responsibility on individuals who don't have the resources, right, to actually make some of those ideals come true. So I'll use the example I just used about travel. If I'm a single mother and I'm working and I gotta take two buses to work, I've just wasted about 2 to 2.5 hours on average, one way of my day and then the other coming back. Working 8 hours, trying to ensure that my child either has access to some type of care, which the largest increase in all services over the last year has been child care. So the balance is that we have to use programming to actually help that mother find ways to engage with her child, right? So how does, for example, Read Charlotte, we've been talking about how to use apps, right, through phones to actually send out messages that remind parents of when to read, right, to their children or how to interact with them. But at the same time, we've got to fix that systematic issue because she can actually change that individual behavior at some level, but it only can take us so far if she still got that 5 hour gap in time that she has to account for. So I think the balance has to be between both of those. So you're spot on. I think what's happened though, we've allowed a more conservative elements in our community though to focus so much on the individual responsibility, right? As if it's not there. I came from a community in poverty. I'll tell you, my mother emphasized education. She was a migrant straight off the fields of Alabama. Migrated at the age of 16, graduated high school, but because her parents didn't know much about education and college, she had to leave on her own. Now, she just earned her 2 bachelor's degrees at the age of 65. Okay?
And we all got to do that.
And we got to do that.
I'm not going to stay that all along, y'all. And
she's
going to do that.
And she's right on.
Yes.
But at the same time, I do realize that certain systems are moving. She worked for years, right, as a manager of a doctor's office. And you know what her doctor told me? I'm actually going to be speaking at their synagogue in February. And he's someone dear to me. He said to me straight out, "Your mother is smarter than you. What she lacked was opportunity." He said, "Louise, she's smarter than me. She can tell me anything about the body right now, and sometimes amazing, but what she lacked was the opportunity."
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you, and I am your biggest fan, so I'm glad to be here. And I have been at the Urban League to see your accomplishments, and you amaze me. I remember about 18 months ago when the county, my colleagues were talking about this mobility study, and before I knew anything about it, I talked to the head of the Poverty Center at Chapel Hill, and Professor Nichols, isn't it right, Chris Nichols, and he, because I said, why are we doing this? Why are we spending all this money? Why are we paying this, these consultants $75,000 from Myers Park to lead this? And he's like, he told me, he said, the Urban League has already done all of the data. They need to just involve that and start doing actions right away. That's what he told me. And then I find out that you're not even on the task force. And I am shocked and I'm embarrassed that you're not.
And I can just say, what can we do to wake them up? Because you already have the data. You've already done the work. And you're out there in the community making a difference. And I'm just so frustrated by this.
Well, this goes back to one of those things that I talked about. And it's not about me or the Earthly, but it's about a larger issue. And that is this notion of intellectual inclusion. One of the reasons that you bumped into that is because of where it was coming from. See, this had to be blessed by our institutions. And I'm not an institution guy. I'm not even a black aristocracy guy. So one of the problems that we have is this notion of intellectual inclusion of others, and at times the appropriation of others' ideas. And so we simply just take those and we run somewhere else with them. The reality is, part of why you probably had to see someone get an outside study to reaffirm what we said inside is because of, again, and I've seen this with other organizations, the profit in your own town mentality. So that means, you know, from the biblical standpoint, you know, a prophet in his own town gets no honor. The reality is that State of Ethnic Charlotte study and what we did got us named by the National Urban League as the most innovative affiliate of the year. We were also named the most improved affiliate for the decade in 2014. But here's the reality. Every day to place people, we struggle financially to do it. That's a reality. Over 89% of those assisted due to the disparities, are African American. But less than 10% of our budget comes from African Americans. So at some level we have to, right, engage, number one, in something that's working. And I don't just say that. I serve on boards, I serve on two committees in Raleigh on policy, and I also looked at this as a historian. So I look at it from a historical standpoint. And what you often find with a lot of the groups and communities that we create is that they have to be blessed by the powers that be. That is not anymore, we can't necessarily say that that is a practice that can work in the future, because we have too much of a diverse community and too much of a diverse notion of what leadership is and what it needs to do. So we're gonna have to find ways to bridge that more. So if you were to ask me why wouldn't a State of Ethnic Charlotte have been used earlier when it first came out, that's some of the reason. Intellectual inclusion. What's really crazy about it, I use Claude Alexander. Claude Alexander said that study was just as important as the Putnam study. And at the time, he was leading CBI in study. But the reality is that it was coming from a deeply entrenched human service organization with a leader who was not part of grander black or white shop. Mm-hmm. Okay. That's what happened.
Thank you, Dr.
Logan. Thank you, Brown. You left out, I don't think it was deliberate, I think you were not here, you left out a very important part of the history of the Urban League and Charlotte.
I know about it too.
The bottom line from my perspective is, from being an insider, I've been CEO of two Urban Leagues, is that Charlotte, the power structure, because that was the power structure of Charlotte, resisted the entry of the Urban League to Charlotte.
It did.
And there were several meetings among the top people in New York and the folks here on how to get an Urban League.
And Mr. Babb was involved in it.
Lord, yes, he was.
Yes, 10 seconds.
I always get cut off. See how the power structure runs back out of my ears. The bottom line is, the power structure is shallow. The soul there, soul with the devil. And I say that because two basic missions of the urban leaders.
You're getting it back.
I hope so. Two basic missions of the urban leaders: public advocacy, fighting for the underprivileged of that. The old term at risk, fighting for them, and then providing socioeconomic programs to help them get into the system. And they sold out the public advocacy. And I can give you a lot of information.
Go ahead and ask your question now.
The question is, to what extent are you familiar with that history, and to what extent are you committed to move over into the strong, dangerous territory of public advocacy?
Okay, so let me answer that question in two ways. One is that we obviously have focused a lot on the service itself, right? Because the one thing that we noticed is that there were services that were lacking to move these people into our economy. And we have to be very strategic about it. So when I tell you about the national certifications, our partnership with the bank, which Joel was a part of, those were all very intentional strategies to move people up the economic ladder and give them entrance into a system, right? So I think that we've accomplished that with the resources we have. I think that we need to expand those resources, that's one. Two, on the public side, a lot of times we look at advocacy in terms of someone being out in the street, right? But I will tell you, you need that. You need that. And I've actually supported a lot of those organizations behind the scenes with actual data. Right? What I've been trying to drive them to, though, is to be very specific about not just what they don't like, but what do you want it to look like? So you got to come with an alternative that actually has numbers tied to it, things that we can measure, which is so important. If you don't, then yes, we can do all of those things. We had a great 60s movement and 70s. I think that it moved us down the field some, but the reality is we are now facing the greatest disparities in our economy than we've faced since that time. So what I would say to you is that some of the advocacy that we do, everyone has a role. My role, as well as the Urban League role, is to begin to sit inside boardrooms, just like Whitney did. It's also to be able to sit with policymakers and have very intimate discussions. There are some, even elected officials, and some who want to run, who will tell you that I've had very, and Joel's one of his intimate conversations about what we think should happen. But we have to have both. We have to be inside and outside. The way that you cook something is with pressure from outside, it's on the stove, and from inside the pot itself by closing the lid and getting in and do some work. So I think that what you're alluding to is a criticism that I've had, have heard before. Well, Patrick, I haven't seen you out there marching this month. And I said, well, the reality is, when you have to serve people every day and raise money to serve them every day, I don't have the luxury of being on the pavement. But what I do is I meet with private citizens, companies, individuals, and talk about what can they do internally to help people move up this ladder. How can they be more inclusive? And then for those who are out there in the street, and there's a lot of those who have been out there that I've had conversation with, I can tell you that some of those very things in policy were handed right over to them, and they have used them as part of their platform. It's not that I don't believe that that's worthwhile. I do. I have young professionals who do it all the time with this type of organization. But the reality is, I can't raise money, run a business, help 1,400 plus people get employed, and help another 1,000 kids get educated, and then have time to do that to them. I have to pick and choose. And I have to say, I'll support you this way, and internally I have to do this, because the reality is you don't get $34 million in salaries by me being outside on the pavement. I had to be in somebody's marble floor talking about how we can make this happen. You need both.
Thank you. Jackie?
Jackie's next question.
Yeah,
I'm
Dr. Graham, you mentioned just a little bit about what young professionals are doing. But I was going to ask you about the young professional group with the Urban League.
Oh, good. So our young professionals, there are about 80 members in that group. And our young professionals are doing a great job in terms of their own advocacy. So they've focused a lot on helping us with issues of connecting to health organizations. Because as a workforce agency, entrepreneurship, and financial literacy, we realize there are other issues that are affecting our customers. But we can't do all of that. I'm not a health agency, right? I've got partners like Caring and others for that. So what we do as the young professionals for is to make those connections and keep those relationships. So for example, they did a health fair with Novant and some other health organizations. Recently, we had over 400 people attend, over 160 free eyeglass prescriptions given at that, with the actual glasses there on site. You know, things like that. Those are some of the things our young professionals are doing. The other thing is we have money where we're trying to, and this should be near and dear to your heart, talking to folks at the rec center where you usually meet to try to redo those courts. We brought in dollars for it, but we can't get traction on the other side to get the other half. So we were willing to give $15,000 to $20,000 from another funding source to help repair that. Those are our young professionals. That's the types of things that they're doing. So if you have the opportunity, look up www.urbanleaguecc.org. That's our website. And you can see some of the things that our young professionals are doing and ways to get involved with them. Our young professionals also have been active in helping us develop policy initiatives, particularly because of their demographic. There are certain things that they're facing, obviously, that many of us are not. You know, when I look in this room, we probably have some young professionals, right, by definition, but not nearly enough, especially if we're talking about movements, right? So we need more. And we need to also, and I'll just say this, Jackie, and I don't want to step on any toes, but this is the reality. Some of us need to step aside and be in support roles. It's time. The problem is we like to hang on past the prime. You don't always have to be out in front to lead. Leadership comes in other forms. And I have found that that has been problematic for a lot of our young professionals as they come here, because they say, how do I navigate through this? How do I make a difference? Martin Luther King was 26 years old, died at 39. So he started as a young professional and died as a young professional. So we know that we can do that. We can entrust these young people to lead. Problem is, are we willing to step aside
and support them?
Oh, I'm sorry. My question is always have a statement. And bear with me. But I'm hearing the words corporate, I'm hearing education, I'm hearing social mobility, I'm hearing inside, outside as regards to task force and research and things like that. What I'm trying to understand is, for myself, I'll say, I always had a healthy skepticism with organizations, whether they be the Urban League, the NAACP, names that I've been hearing for a long time throughout the struggle. And when we talk about about the needle not moving the way we would like it to, I kind of understand that to be a result of corporatocracies and policy structures and things like that. and even stepping aside that you just talked about, I guess my question is, how do we translate, or how do you translate institutions into progress with numbers you just spoke about, like the 1 to 4? Is that enough to move the social mobility, or is that, or have you seen that as enough to move the social mobility, or is that a drop in the pan? Is what I'm looking for. Can you context that?
Sure, it is a drop in the bucket. Okay. And a lot of that is based off of where we are actually spending resources. So when Senator Ford talked about this notion of resource, to me it's not always about new resources, it's redirecting to where they actually make sense. So for example, I'll tell you that, and I see our county commissioner Trevor Fuller here, about 7 years ago, just as we were about to hit the economic downturn, the county commission at the time, Brother Fuller, had their priorities. There was 12. Did you know that job development was not in their top 7 in the town? It didn't move up, right, until the economic crisis came. So the reason I say that is, if we focus resources where they are always going to be needed, you're always going to need education, you're always going to need job creation, you're always going to need, then they should always be in your top 2 priorities at all times, in good and bad times. And so what I'm saying to you is that you are correct as a drop in the bucket. And I don't look at it necessarily as skepticism. I look at it as being realistic about how much we're moving. Those 1,400 people that we placed in employment and some of our partners placed in employment, whatever their numbers are still, yes, drops in the bucket because there's not been a hard focus of resources there. Think about that $34 million. That was earned with just $800,000. That's a small amount of money to devote to a struggling population, right, of thousands of people. So I look at it from 2 standpoints. One is that I know that we can make systems work because we're doing it with this smaller group. The point is that we need to expand that so that it includes more people, more resources. Take some of the resources we devote to something and place them in those types of initiatives. To me, it's just a matter of refocusing where we spend our resources. Ultimately, too, though, it will require both the private sector and the public sector to have some courage in doing that.
Thank you. The last 2 questions are going to be from Carlina and Dr. Foley.
Oh, wow, that came out of the
mouth. Yeah, I'll get it.
Patrick, it's quite obvious that you fit very strongly about people their age stepping aside and giving other I agree with you. I think that it's a time and a place, and I think that individuals need to make sure that they're lifting others up. What type of succession plan do you have, or maybe your young professionals, to say, we would like an opportunity by meeting with some of those individuals and say, how can you help us and lift us up? Do you have a succession plan in place?
So internally in the organization, yes. What we do with young professionals as well as staff is constantly train, and my citizen trainings all the time, and I'm always thinking about what happens if I disappear, right, in the organization itself. So I'll start at that level. So I have young professionals now that I know in a few years could be ready to run an organization because a lot of them actually are showing leadership right now in their corporate spaces. It's just that they, because many of them are migrants to the area, have not really found ways to connect in community because it is one that sort of has its, the best way to put it, cliques. So it's very hard to navigate when you come from outside. You know, I'm amazed that I'm even here. Because I still can't really see how did I get connected coming from somewhere else, right? So that's one. But two, I think that when we are in power, even in organizations like this, it becomes our responsibility now to reach out. Right? We're expecting people to come to us. But they can't come if they don't know you exist. I liken it to this whole notion of West Charlotte. I had someone ask me the question one time. Why do you not see more of Charlotte's middle class and middle upper class African Americans involved in initiatives in West Charlotte? Why don't they come back?
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
And I said, well, see, that's the first issue. You're talking about people coming back to something they've never been part of. Yeah. The majority of those folks are not from here. They don't have an idea of this history. This is where you come in. You have to actually create that.
Yes.
It won't happen organically.
Right.
It has to be intentional. This landscape has changed. You know, what is the latest stat? 17% of us are originally from Charlotte? I mean, think about what that means in terms of people's connectivity. So I think that you have a lot of people who could be very instrumental in development, but they're not connected. And they don't feel invited, right? So we have to find better ways to do that. And so when I told them that, I said, well, these people have never been there, right?
You're right.
They were shocked. They said, I never thought about that. I said, oh, well, you thought, so, I mean, you thought because, you know, we might have similar skin color that somehow, organically, that drives me to be cousins with somebody I ain't never seen before? That means practicing the same thing that others think about us. We all know each other. I mean, I have people sometimes ask me, do you know so-and-so from Arkansas? I'm like, no, why would I know him?
I do.
Yeah, I understand your dilemma in terms of having to raise money and to serve as an effective public advocate. I've been there, done that. One of the areas where I recommend that you get involved seriously is the public school system, which is still doing what Dr. Carla G. Woodson said in 1933 in his book, The Miseducation of the Negro. Our students are being killed. I don't say that very lightly. They are being killed through the public school system, going from the school system to the prison system. And I've documented that in several books already. So I suggest you may want to get involved strongly with the public school system and their long, ugly record of miseducating black students.
So is that part of
the question was, I invite you to be a little bit more active in terms of.
Okay, so let me just say this. We are in 8 schools now.
Good.
We're in 8 schools.
Doing what though?
We're doing education, technology training, but one of the things that I pointed out to you all in the presentation, which I think is important, and again, to me it's more about not just saying what you're doing, but proving it, is that in those 8 schools, as reported to us by the teachers themselves, those schools, not us, 91% grade gains for all youth in our programs in those 8 schools. 91%. If you look too at Rivergate and Sterling Elementary, the 2 elementary schools we're in, those enrolled in our technology program, 40 to 60% increase in the end of grade testing, pass rates. So what I would say to you is, what we need is just more capacity to keep doing that. We just don't have it. So see, this is why I pointed to the fact that I have to be out raising money and other. CMS doesn't pay for that. We raise that privately and bring it to the school. So there's the difference. So not only have we been part of it, but we've literally devoted our human capital and resource to it when they didn't have the money themselves. So I think that if we do more things like that and we expand that pie, we can be in more schools. and we can have more success stories like a Rivergate or a Sterner. So again, there's the notion of being outside, which is important. That's the fire, cooking. What I do is I close the lid and get into the pot and work internally to try to get it back. Because some of our kids can't wait for the revolution to finish doing what it's gonna do. They need help right now.
Thank you again, Dr. Lamb. And I want, you know, since I've been here over a little over 90 years, and I have trained so all of my girls, stand up, my presiders. Stand up, y'all. All my girls. I come every Tuesday because they come and get me. But I don't have to do anything. I don't have to schedule anybody because they do it. That's how you do it. I'm trying to do the same thing at church. Okay, now also, the Urban League, when Nadine was there, she presented me and Franklin McCain the Thurgood Marshall Award, and we passed on a torch to Jackie. Okay, Jackie, you know Jackie. Okay, Jackie and Anthony Hunt. And actually, Jackie, Anthony's going to be here helping us with this Tuesday breakfast for her. Okay, now let's see. I got so much I need to say. I hope all of you had a good Christmas and are just starting off just with a blessed new year. Okay, all right, I am going to announce to you. Oh, first of all, Steve, the reason we aren't getting any money back there, that thing says free coffee. And let me tell you, some folk have been putting in enough money to pay for the coffee, maybe. But when we didn't get it, but when we got a little over, Steve would always make a contribution to the center where we were meeting. He isn't getting that anymore. So, now, you all, if you come here and get a cup of coffee, please bring a dollar, okay? Thank you. I will appreciate that very much. Okie dokie, the next announcement. We are going to be moving. We have been invited to begin our meetings at the Belmont Regional Center at 700 Hogwood Avenue. That's where the Charlotte Mecklenburg Community Relations, that's my home, you know. I raised up Willie over, and Donna. As a matter of fact, I convinced Jack Bullock to give Willie the job that Willie has, and that was Jack's job. And Donna, the job that I had when I was doing the speech center. Okay, so anyway, I could just keep on talking, but I don't need to keep on doing that. Okay, thank you, Ken. Okay, at the day after Martin Luther King's birthday.
Is the first one?
But we'll meet here next week. This will be our last time. I have announced it to the young lady out there. And let's thank her for being so cooperative. But we're going to have more space and better facilities there. So I want all of you to meet me here next week, but then meet me over on Belmont at 700 Parkwood Avenue. Okay? On the 19th. Okay. And then I'll probably have some more stuff to tell y'all. Thank you so much. I appreciate everything. Okay.
Thank you. If our elected officials would mind just coming up, if you all have any updates.
Yes.
Joel, Trevor, Julie, Sylvia. Elected officials, if I miss anyone, apologize.
Good morning, everyone. Good morning, everyone. Happy New Year. Happy 2016. Reverend Fuller the name.
Yeah, Trevor, you know, I have been saying to these groups, you all need to get together. You see, I've been saying that for so long, the city council, county commission, school board, have you made any?
No. We are working on it.
You're working on that? Well, work a little harder on it, okay? Okay, and there's some other things. Y'all just wait.
That young lady that didn't get a chance to speak, the one that you said one.
Oh, yeah, one of them. Okay, all right. Yeah, take this stuff, because I'll keep talking. Okay, Charles, pass me some of this speed bump. Thank you.
I'm Pat Kaufman, County Commissioner at Large, and again, I want to thank Dr. Graham for being here. It's amazing. Amazing. Thank you.
I'm Julie Eiselt. I'm City Council at Large, and yes, we are talking to each other, and as a new council member, that's a real priority for me, is to work with our schools, our school leaders, our county commissioners, our really wonderful advocates that work behind the scenes to make a difference in the community and to connect the dots with all that. So thank you.
Great, thank you. We'll go right into announcements, so we'll start on this side, my right, your left. If you raise your hand, Charles will come on the microphone.
On January 23rd from 9 to 11 at Industry Co-working and the Music Factory, we'll have Digital Charlotte's Community Impact Day, where we'll be sharing resources on how to help close the digital divide for providers, access, and devices. I'll share the website.
By show of hands, how many of you are familiar with the Grand Heights community and the Grand Heights Community Center? On this Friday at 11 o'clock, Antioch Baptist